Thank you very much, Agnieszka. And I would like to thank you, Demuseum, for having invited me to the conference. I'm having a very good time, and I hope you too. Okay, art as an agent of modernization, Władysław Strzemiński's double politics of social change, the museum and the artistic culture. I will start with a motto. It is not enough to create a good work of art. It is also necessary to create the appropriate conditions for it to exert influence. The motto comes from a letter by Władysław Strzemiński to Julian Przyboś of 1929. And I believe this is a good start for my talk. The avant-garde has often been defined in terms of originality and novelty, or viewed through the prism of experiments with the artistic form, language, medium, or communication process. It has been also considered as an attempt to integrate art with the praxis of everyday life and as an enterprise of designing the social change and creating visions of the new man, new culture, and new society. This has led to interpreting the avant-garde as radical, but also utopian artistic and cultural movement. In fact, the notion of the utopian has largely contributed to questioning and dismantling of these radical social and political imperatives of the avant-garde. As a result, it is quite commonly presumed that the latter might have been radical, but its radicalism was empty and unreal, purely phantasmatic. Less often, even nowadays, the avant-garde is described and defined in terms of what the above-mentioned letter from Władysław Strzemiński to Julian Przyboś indicates, namely in terms of the necessity and capability of creating new circumstances for radical artistic and socio-political ideas to get culturally enrooted, socially legitimized, and politically implemented. In order to create these appropriate circumstances, the avant-garde had to be able to function and perform efficiently within the real conditions of a particular time and place. As in the famous opening of the 18th Brumaire of Louis Bonaparte by Karl Marx, and I quote, "Men make their own history, but they do not make it as they please. They do not make it under self-selected circumstances, but under circumstances existing already, given and transmitted from the past," end of quote. Accordingly, the avant-garde was forced to negotiate its position within the existing conditions of the fields of artistic production and social life. It had to develop realistic, complex, and sometimes ambivalent tactics, engaged into pragmatic actions and initiatives. It is here that the so-called utopism of the avant-garde gets replaced by, or at least supplemented with, its operativity, good judgment, and effectivity, enterprising spirit and resourcefulness, that is with its ability, sometimes highly developed, to self-organize and self-institutionalize in the public sphere. This very aspect has directed my own research on artistic and organizational practices of Polish constructivist artist Władysław Strzemiński. I am particularly interested in his expanded idea of art as an agent of cultural and social modernization and in how he strove to implement it, how he negotiated with existing historical circumstances in order to change them and create new ones, such that would help his artistic and social ideas to exert influence and become actualized. In what follows, I will present some general premises of my interpretive work with Strzemiński's heritage. I will show how, in his case, the modernization imperative translated into what I call a double politics. It is in this context that I will briefly situate his successful attempt at creating the International Collection of Modern Art, which later became the basis of the Muzeum Sztuki in Łódź as a museum of the avant-garde. The point will be to show what role the collection deposited in a municipal museum in Łódź and made accessible to the general public was to play in Strzemiński's overall modernization politics. In the second part of my presentation, I will consider how this modernization heritage could be taken up, updated, activated, and performed institutionally today. Namely, I will propose to reflect on the possibility of repurposing and updating the idea of the Museum of Artistic Culture as an institution capable of providing a relevant and responsible answer to the avant-garde ethos and heritage of modernization. I will do so with a reference to the project entitled The Effectivity of Art, organized by myself on the invitation from the Museum Sztuki in the years 2012-2014. It is one of the projects through which the institution has tried to work with and rework this modernization heritage of the avant-garde in the sphere of contemporary artistic and activist practices. So part one, Władysław Strzemiński's double politics. The issue of Władysław Strzemiński's political stance and political implications of his art have been an object of controversy and divergent interpretations for decades. His art has been associated with leftist ideas, such as socialism or communism, or with social solidarism under the direction of the middle class, as well as held structurally equivalent and linked to industrial capitalism. It has been also provocatively suggested that certain social implications of his art make it dangerously close to fascism. Last but not least, the artist has been accused of political opportunism or being completely apolitical, unable to take any political stance. I think that in order to sift through all these interpretations and look at the question of Strzemiński's politics in the right perspective, it has to be assumed that art was for him a politics of modernization, to be more precise, a double politics. The artist never explicitly equals art with politics, nor does he suggest that artistic practice should be subordinated to a political cause. Nevertheless, there seem to be in his texts from the 1920s and 1930s two implicit interconnected concepts, or two aspects of a single concept, of art as politics. I propose to call one of them an ideological politics of ends, or to use a common concept of the era, a mission, and the other one, a pragmatic realpolitik of means, or a tactics. The former comprised of his modernization program, while the latter was to create appropriate conditions for its implementation. Reversing traditional premises of the concept of political art, Strzemiński seems to imply that one should not proceed by expressing an already articulated political stance in art, but infer from the very specificity of modern art its own socio-political implications and take them as one's life attitude and political stance. And I quote, "As long as we do not draw from modern art its social and ideological implications, the logic of its form, modern art will float in mid-air and will not find its social extension. I am not speaking of agitation or taking a political stand and expressing it by means of art, but of the logic of a life attitude towards facts of individual life, the life of the author, as well as towards facts of the wider life, the logic that stems from the logic of artistic forms." End of quote. Now, we might wonder what life attitude, whatever kinds of social political ideas, forms and practices stem from formal logic of modern art. In other words, what politics should follow from it? Strzemiński's answer to this question is to be sought in what I have called the ideological politics of ends. The latter, co-authored by Strzemiński and his wife, artist Katarzyna Kobro, entailed redefining art, transforming and expanding its concept. Art was no longer to function as a formal ornament of life. It was to be seen as giving shape to life itself, quote, organizing the course of life processes, end of quote. This radically expanded concept of art still keeps the possibility of engaging in such traditional art practices as painting a picture or constructing a sculpture. Yet, it confers on them a new function and meaning. Let's reconstruct its logic. A singular artwork is a formal experiment, an exercise in art, but also a kind of a research task. This makes art into something very close to science, the methods of which it might also apply. Art becomes knowledge production. Artistic experiments lead to discovery or creation of new organization rules and methods that are inferred out of a singular work and articulated as coherent concepts. Such concepts, when applied to mass production, can become the basis for designing buildings and objects of everyday use, which start to shape a living space and actions of mass consumers. It is in this way that art was to organize the course of life processes according to the standards and norms of the modern world. It is also in this way that art becomes a culturalist and Taylorist biopolitics, a bioproduction of modern life, provided that we take the concept of biopolitics in a relatively neutral sense or even in a slightly positive sense. Art should be a tool of modernizing social life according to the principles of scientific management and therefore of making life more productive, functional, economic, and efficient. More precisely, it should become a laboratory of organizational and anthropotechnical models for the design of architectural and urbanist spaces, as well as mass-produced utilitarian objects. Having been built and produced in this way, they are supposed to reshape human habitus and affects, increase human energy and the quality of life. Eventually, they are to stimulate the creation of a rational social community. This Taylorist inspiration is quite explicit in the text of Strzemiński and Kobro. They both made numerous references to the scientific organization of labor, which was a European term for Frederick Taylor's scientific management and similar concepts of organization. They also referred to the theory of Karol Adamiecki, a Polish economist and engineer who invented his own version of scientific management, largely independent of Taylor's, and also Bogdanov might be mentioned in this very context. Yeah. The biopolitics of Taylorism must have really appealed to both artists. They saw it as a genuinely modern way of organizing life. Planned and managed by a single decision-making center, the Taylorist politics was thought to be effective and efficient, freed from a destabilizing play of forces and devoid of all superfluous verbiage and rhetorical blitz that was so typical of traditional political activity. Accordingly, Strzemiński's modernizing, progressive Taylorist politics of modern art could not be identified and equaled with any of the traditional political views, doctrines, and systems. Instead, it offered a measure for evaluating those views and systems so as to determine if and to what degree they created appropriate circumstances for its own development and implementation. It was from the perspective of this modernization politics that the artist evaluated actual economic and socio-political circumstances and kept on inventing different tactics to act efficiently within their changing context. This is exactly where Strzemiński's politics of ends had to open itself to a supplementary type of action, the one that I have termed the pragmatic realpolitik of means. The latter was supposed to strive for appropriate conditions and necessary means, institutional, social, political, economic, etc., that would provide modern art with social legitimacy and a power to modernize social life. This kind of politics implied a necessity of entering the field of antagonistic forces and interests. Its task was to remove factors which blocked or weakened the social impact of modern art and hindered the process of its becoming a biopolitics of modern life. It should be also noted that it was mainly Strzemiński himself who performed this realpolitik of means. Kobro, most probably for the reasons of nationality, language, and the patriarchal society, was engaged in it to a lesser extent. An excellent source for reconstruction of this politics of means are Strzemiński's letters. They show him not only as a creator of a radical project of modernizing art and social life, but, and above all, as a realist and a pragmatic, who is capable of tactical actions aimed at implementing this very project. The artist was perfectly aware how the public sphere functioned and knew the influence that the printed press could exert on the public opinion. He considered it necessary for modern artists to advertise their art in order to create a desired public image of it. He wanted to shape a social imaginarium by creating a strong association between modern art and various phenomena of technological and economic modernization. Therefore, he was taking part in public discussions, giving lectures and presentations, but also, and above all, he was writing and publishing texts in Polish art and literary journals, as well as in everyday press. He was an indefatigable advocate of modern art. He kept on defending it, educating on it, proving its cultural, social, and economic relevancy, and granting it its rightful place among agents of modernizations. He organized press campaigns and created press facts to support modern art and defend it against the accusation of those who criticized it and wanted to delegitimize it. Also, he sought for collaboration and coalition within the art scene, as well as for institutional and political support for his enterprises. In the interwar period, his politics of means involves the co-creation and participation in subsequent artistic groups, Bloc, Presence, and AR group. Here we've got only three members of the AR group. Starzewski and Brzękowski are not present in the photograph. He also participated in the creation of the Union of Polish Visual Artists in Łódź, a collective subjectivity and public representation of artists. Last not least, Strzemiński, together with Kobro, developed an original art and design educating program and took every effort to implement it in different schools in Nowa Wilejka, Szczekociny, Koluszki, and Łódź. And yet, already at the end of the 1920s, the time which constituted a turning point in many respects, economic, sociopolitical, cultural, and artistic, Strzemiński saw in retrospect that modern art had managed to gain in Poland neither the social legitimacy nor the necessary symbolic and material means of action. In his text Bilanced Modernizmu, An Assessment of Modernism of 1929, he answers to some critical voices raised against modern art in Poland. In his opinion, the reason behind the misunderstanding of modern art and the hostile reception it used to get at the time was the lack of proper artistic tradition in Poland, the absence of progressive development of artistic forms and tendencies in the early modern or pre-modern period. And I quote, "We are accused of not being on firm ground, or of not having any connection to the tradition of past generations, of importing foreign trends and novelties. That is indeed a fact. We have no common tradition with this very generation that has wasted Polish art. We are referring not to decline, but to progress. We are developing a connection to foreign art because our own predecessors have made art into something hostile to art itself." End of quote. Another and deeper reason is indicated in a letter to Przybosz, where Strzemiński writes about the necessity of accounting for, and I quote, "the sociological foundation of modernism," end of quote. It seems that it was here that he saw the source of the problem. In his view, Poland lacked such proper sociological foundation of modernism. Even though modern art, when it comes to its psychophysiological impact, was perfectly suited to the aesthetic needs and requirements of the contemporary viewer, it was not appreciated there in Poland, but instead treated with suspicion, prejudice, and hostility. For Strzemiński, this could not be explained solely in artistic or aesthetic terms, but had to derive from a more general social approach to life. And I quote, "The approach to modern art is but a symptom of a much more general approach to modern life phenomena," end of quote. Accordingly, he started to seek for and critically reconstructed wider historical, geopolitical, socio-economic and cultural factors that could have been responsible for the absence of a hospitable milieu in Poland for both modernity and modern art. Anticipating some general tenets of both modernization theories and post-colonial studies, the artist considered factors that enable the modernization process as internal to a particular country or region, and the process itself as linear, evolutionary, irreversible, and basically the same for all countries and societies, insofar as it goes through the same necessary phases everywhere. On the other hand, he was conscious of the fact that the period of colonial dependency leaves its mark on the mentality, habits, culture, and way of life of its society and can exercise its influence long after the country regains its political sovereignty. A combination of the two perspectives, a very specific combination, I should add, set a kind of analytical frame which he applied to Polish history and culture. Among the factors he identified as responsible for the backwardness and anti-modernistic sentiments of the Polish society were the partitions of Poland in the 18th century and their long-term impact, the ideology of Romanticism and Sarmaticism, socio-economic and geopolitical genealogy of Polish managerial and bureaucratic class, and lastly, a strong nationalist discourse and xenophobic tendencies within the Polish society. These nationalist and xenophobic tendencies were further intensifying in the 1930s during the Sanacja period. Confronting the situation, Strzemiński stressed forcefully that, and I quote, the conditions for the absorption of good art by the masses should be sought for outside of art itself, end of quote. This view was expressed in Blokada Sztuki, the blockade of art of 1934, where he passionately criticizes institutional conditions and socio-political power relations that defined the field of art production and distribution in the 1930s Poland. He attacks those in charge of art institutions and art press who claim that modern art must not enter the public sphere in Poland, as it is not natively Polish and remains foreign to the Polish soul. Since this cultural and institutional politics was shaped by general political tendencies, Strzemiński declares that, and I quote, the border between art and politics has suddenly vanished, end of quote. In effect, artists should take all necessary actions, even militant ones, to fight for political changes that would lead to transformation of the institutional field of art. Strzemiński goes as far as to state that they have to prepare to war, and this preparation is, and I quote, a struggle for a new system, end of quote. Elliptical as this may sound, it is clear that the artist calls for a radical political change that would also lead to a transformation of the institutional field of art. Yet another quote, to be able to assimilate good art, but first of all, to be able to create it with impunity. Yes, with impunity. One would need to rearrange everything here completely, end of quote. It is in this complex and overdetermined context that the International Collection of Modern Art, a cornerstone for the Muzeum Sztuki as a museum of the avant-garde, was created as a grassroots and self-organizational initiative. At the beginning of the 1930s, Strzemiński, together with the other members of the AR group, asked numerous foreign and Polish avant-garde artists to donate their works and thus contribute to the creation of the collection. In 1931, an agreement was signed with the Łódź Municipal Council, in accordance with which the collection was deposited in the building of the Julian and Kazimierz Bartoszewicz Municipal Museum of History and Art and made accessible to the general public. And this is the photograph that Daniel already showed yesterday. This is the very agreement signed by both Przesław Smolik, about whom I will add a few things in a minute, and by Strzemiński. And yes, a crucial role in this was played by Przesław Smolik, the head of Department of Culture and Education at Łódź Municipality, and I stress this, a member of PPS, the Socialist Party of Poland, the very same political force that, according to Strzemiński, did not follow from modern art. So this is a kind of ironic. The task of the collection as a cornerstone for a future museum of modern art was at least threefold. First of all, it was to construct an artistic background by way of an invented or imported tradition to create a reference point for future development of modern art in Poland. Second of all, the aim was to educate the general public on the historical genealogy of modern art and therefore provide the latter with cultural authority, social legitimacy and appreciation. Aesthetic appreciation in the first place. Finally, the collection was to promote modernity at large and contribute to the creation of a genuinely modern social subjectivity in Poland. It was to transform the collective imaginarium and reinvent the Polish soul that would be ready to this time rise to the challenge of modern life and support modernization plans of artists and designers. In order to perform effectively this complex task, the museum and its collection was to act in a kind of network of mutually supporting and cooperating institutions. In my opinion, Strzemiński started to build such a network of institutional connections in the aftermath of World War II, trying to take advantage of new socio-political circumstances that were created by communist authorities. In the late 1940s, taking different tactical steps, he was trying to encourage cooperation between the renamed Muzeum Sztuki in Łódź with its international collection of modern art, the newly established State Higher School of Visual Art in Łódź, where he worked and where he participated in the creation of the Department of Spatial Design, and finally, factories representing different branches of industry. He also wanted to establish a link between artistic and scientific institutions, so he chose to cooperate with the journal Myśl Współczesna, the Contemporary Thought, which was edited by a circle of progressive left-wing intellectuals and researchers from the newly established University of Łódź. They sought to develop a socially engaged, egalitarian university which would produce knowledge necessary to enhance an ongoing social change as well as to help rebuild the country destroyed during the war and modernize it. Strzemiński believed that the modernization politics of modern art could be implemented only by means of this institutional coalition. He acted as a mediating agent between all those professional and institutional circles as a kind of a central node in the network that was slowly being created, not without difficulties. The introduction of Stalinism and the doctrine of socialist realism in Poland in 1949, the artist's firing from the State Higher School of the Visual Art in 1950, and his death in 1952 put an end to these networking efforts. And now part two, the Museum of Artistic Culture, a need for a contemporary reappraisal and an update of the idea. As Andrzej Turowski has indicated, one of the main sources for Strzemiński's concept of modern art collection and museum is to be sought in his Russian period, and more specifically, in discussions around the notion of the Museum of Artistic Culture and attempts to create a network of such institutions that took place in the post-revolutionary Russia in the late 1910s and the early 1920s. Strzemiński participated in the meetings of the IZO Narkompros, which was the Department of Fine Arts at the People's Commissariat of Education and Enlightenment in Moscow, and played there a vital role in the development of the Central Exhibition Bureau. He knew the ideas and postulates presented during the 1919 Pietrograd Conference on the Museums of Art, organized by IZO Narkompros, during which the very term artistic culture was coined. Finally, he was aware of the unfavorable circumstances of creating new art institutions and also collections in Vitebsk and Smolensk. Judging by his later texts and initiatives in Poland, which were focused on the question of the museum, it seems that there were three main ideas he found inspiring in the discussions around the idea of the Museum of Artistic Culture. Firstly, the very question of artistic culture as the culture of experiment and invention. Secondly, a need to stress the formal aspect of art and organize the museum collection and its exhibition around the evolution of form that leads teleologically to the present artistic achievements and therefore legitimize them and as necessary next steps in the development of art. And thirdly, a need to integrate within the Museum of Artistic Culture the functions of collecting and exhibiting art, providing artistic education for art students and the general public, and establishing a scientific institute for research and experiments in art, architecture, psychophysiology, ergonomics, biomechanics, and so on and so forth, that could be used in the design of utilitarian spaces and objects. I have brought up the subject of the Museum of Artistic Culture so as to present a few sketchy remarks on this very term. I believe that the term could be repurposed and updated today so as to provide a relevant answer to the question of how art museums could institutionally activate the modernization ethos of their avant-garde collections. On the one hand, the Museum of Artistic Collection could henceforth refer to a process of institutional transformation and expansion that is already underway, as museums are trying to reinvent their mission, redefine their tasks, and transgress traditional cultural, socio-political, economic, and legal frames of their functioning. On the other hand, the term in question could refer to a new institutional model, a kind of, it could become a kind of regulative idea that could enhance and direct the process of institutional transformation towards the creation of an institution that would answer faithfully to the modernization imperatives of the avant-garde. I will limit myself to indicating two aspects of this model. Obviously, the contemporary Museum of Artistic Culture should inherit the ethos of modernization in a critical and transformative way. This should begin with the very understanding of the concept of artistic culture. I think that artistic culture should now, after the avant-garde, the neo-avant-garde, and the institutional critique, refer to all artistic activities and to all workings of the field of art production in its relationships with other spheres within the social field. This already poses some challenge to existing institutions. Namely, they should work with, collect, exhibit, research, and educate on not only what is called works of art, but all artifacts, documents, and testimonies of modernization projects of the avant-garde. This, in turn, translates into a need for radically contextual, historical, and educational exhibitions of the avant-garde in its various modernizing efforts and initiatives. Again, both things have already been underway for some time. Looking at the exhibitions organized by the Museum Sztuki as part of the 100 years of Polish avant-garde program, for example, Enrico Prampolini, Futurism, Stage Design, and the Polish Avant-Garde Theater, or the current montages, Deborah Vogel and the New Legend of the City, with all their accompanying events, I am happy to see this tendency growing. The other aspect I want to touch upon is a need for the contemporary Museum of Artistic Culture to support different forms of artistic, cultural, social, political, urban activism and act as a kind of activist or socially engaged institution itself. The question of artistic and institutional activism was an explicit subject of yet another project organized by the Museum Sztuki, and I will share my thoughts on the possibility of museums acting as modernization agents by referring to this very enterprise. Between October 2012 and May 2013, on invitation from and in cooperation with the Muzeum Sztuki, I organized a series of open lectures, presentations, and discussions under the title Effectiveness of Art. The essence of the project was to develop an engaged and at the same time realistic and critical method to define and, most importantly, to assess the effectiveness that contemporary artistic and institutional practices have, or at least may have, in these diverse fields. The idea was also to indicate what conditions must be met for art to be able to gain or increase its effectiveness where it has had no effects thus far. To this end, we decided to break up the general question of the effectiveness of art into a number of more specific, mutually interrelated issues. Together with researchers from various fields, artists, curators, activists, and publicists invited to the project, we looked at artistic activities in the context of the transformation of the capitalist economy, political nature of cultural practices, social values of design, civic activism and urban movements, collaboration of art and science, and finally, tasks and modes of operation of artistic institutions. We are particularly interested in practices exercised in Poland, although there were also references and comparisons to similar phenomena in other countries. The summary of the whole project was the book The Effectiveness of Art, released at the end of 2014. The volume consists of 22 theoretical texts, case studies, interviews with artists and activists, and artistic manifestos. They presented a broad panorama of voices, analytical perspectives, as well as assessments of artistic, activist, and institutional practices. The term effectiveness of art undoubtedly refers to the ethos of the avant-garde, the ethos of changing reality and the need for active involvement in society, both of which define many contemporary artistic ideas and practices. The term also brings to mind disputes about whether art, as the other place, the so-called other place in the social space, is able to shape this space. And if so, with what instruments, to what extent, and based on what values. Thus, the effectiveness of art can be an emblem of the desire to instrumentalize artistic practices, to subordinate them and make them serve external social or political goals, while rejecting the autonomy of the field of art and values that constitute its specificity. However, it can also mean retaining such symbolic autonomy as a kind of laboratory in which different experimental inventions emerge that can be potentially, in an indirect and complex way, transplanted onto a broader social ground. Another distinction is marked by the opposition between real and symbolic action. It is sometimes believed that artistic practices are capable of effecting real cultural, social, or political changes, albeit rather on a micro scale. A different view assumes that if art has any effectiveness, it entails exclusively disclosing and publicizing certain problems by introducing them to the public discourse. The change of which art is capable then is limited to the symbolic transformation of social imaginaries. Even more skeptical commentators suggest that art is incapable of any change, whether real or symbolic. It can only create its visions, and in doing so, provide testimony to the resistance against the hegemonic social order and sustain the very desire to challenge it. Another disputed issue is the question of what cause artistic practices actually, willingly or unwillingly, serve. In addition to concepts that attribute values of emancipation to art and seek its effectiveness in the field where it is realized, there are also ones that presuppose that artistic tools and values today are successfully used on the other side of the barricade, in the service of the mechanisms of power, control, and exploitation. And that is, it is precisely there where art is sometimes amazingly effective. In reference to artistic practices, the very category of effectiveness appears highly suspicious in this context, as it is too strongly associated with the criteria of productivity, efficiency, and measurability, with capitalist values imposed in all spheres of life. Taking all those overdetermined aspects into account, we wanted to look back, analyze specific artistic and institutional practices, and see which of them actually worked and which didn't. What factors influenced their success or failure, and what was achieved or failed to be achieved through them. Thus, our main goal was to critically rework the issue of the effectiveness of art, show its general economy, analyze a number of ambivalences, difficulties, and deficiencies related to activities that turn toward the social, political, economic, and cultural exterior of the field of artistic production. Ultimately, we wanted to mount a complex, careful, and balanced defense of such activities and their potential. Potentials. The book that is the outcome of the project features divergent voices, evaluations, and postulates. I will outline some of my own conclusions from the project concerning art institutions. A common criticism of the so-called social turn in contemporary art, or what may be termed more generally its turn to the outside, points out the inbred and self-reproductive aspect of art, which engages in our spheres of reality in order to expand its own domain, redefine its concept, and gain new potentialities of action. Indeed, art is characterized by a certain narcissism, through which it enters new realms of reality in order to see itself reflected in them and be able to relearn and generate new knowledge about itself, thus generating a symbolic capital for itself and reasserting its own cultural position. It is, if one can risk such a term, structural narcissism, independent of the actual altruism and social empathy of individual artists. This narcissistic aspect must be taken into account in any analysis of art that turns to the outside, regardless of whether we are dealing with a social, cultural, educational, ethical, political, or any other turn. We need to develop a critical awareness of the forms of appropriation and instrumentalization to which elements of social life are subject in artistic and institutional practices, becoming fuel for generating economic and symbolic capital for the art world, as well as consolidating the aesthetic, cultural, economic, and class distinctions that build it. However, when formulating justified criticism of these phenomena, we cannot forget that they are of structural nature and cannot be avoided completely. It is then a question of establishing the right relation, the right economy between this narcissistic generating capital for oneself and redistributing different forms of symbolic, cultural, social, political, economic capital within the social field. The effectiveness of art is often understood in terms of the production of alternative patterns of prototypes of social reality, models of human relations, exchange, economy, participation, cooperation, communalism, etc. Let us suppose that such a model is actually produced within an art institution on the symbolic level. Then we can wonder if there is a contradiction between the symbolic level and the real functioning of contemporary artistic institutions in the capitalist system. The question is to what extent such institutions, taking into account their inherent habitus and external economic, legal, and political conditions, are really capable of implementing such an alternative model of relations, both in their own operation as well as their social environment. This question is still too rarely considered in the field of art. This especially concerns art institutions, which are increasingly willing to engage in social projects and support artistic activism, but do not make sufficient efforts to disseminate and socialize values that are produced in the course of such projects. The capital generated by these projects falls into the void because they lack opportunity for redistribution. art is not responsible for models created in its field, it doesn't know how to take care of their further social fate. Even on the symbolic level, not to mention the real one. Art and artistic institutions offer those models, but do not seek to implement them. This applies particularly to art institutions, because today they not only support manifestations of social activism in artistic practices, but declare activists' ambitions themselves and are willing to self-present as instruments of social change. So far, such institutional activism has been mainly significant for the institutions themselves, paving a way for them to open to new opportunities, to transform their status, to invent and define themselves anew. However, it may be a necessary stage on the way to take action for actual redistribution of capital generated by practices implemented within their framework. This redistribution could be encouraged if museums, in addition to the Department of Exhibitions, to the Department of Research, Promotion and Education, established departments of social activism. The latter would be in charge of implementing artistic prototypes in the social field, both in-house as well as in collaboration with external subjects and institutions that could take them over and use in their own social activities. This is necessary as a broader, more effective and systemic redistribution of the various forms of capital generated by art requires alliances and collaboration of both artists and art institutions with other subjects, institutional subjects, operating in the public sphere. Such department of social activism should be another element of the contemporary Museum of Artistic Culture as an heir to the avant-garde ethos of modernization. If I had enough time to look at certain other projects of the Muzeum Sztuki, which despite numerous and multiplying unfavorable circumstances, supports local artistic activism, gets involved in long-term projects on meta-educating the educators, and tries to use its cultural capital to intervene into the ongoing process of urban revitalization in Łódź, I could show that the institution may be already on the way to establishing such a department. I hope it will take place in the near future. Thank you very much.